guest. Bruce Bozzi Jr. is the Executive Vice President of Palm Management Corporation, managing locations of the Palm Restaurant all across the U.S. Celebrities dine at the Palm, making it the iconic institution that it is. Bruce also hosts a show on SiriusXM's Radio Andy called Lunch with Bruce, where he interviews celebrities as they eat the famous Palm food. Everyone, please give a warm brunch welcome to Bruce Bozzi Jr.
Hi.
Hello.
Hi, John.
How are you?
Please take a seat.
Well, this is exciting.
Welcome to Build Brunch.
Thank you. I just have to acknowledge that, you know, I was at the Justin and Jen wedding, which was a great wedding. It was really filled. It was filled with love, and they are two incredibly special people. So, and I agree with what you were saying, which is sometimes forever is forever, and it doesn't mean it's not successful. So, like, a 10-year relationship is a 10-year relationship. It doesn't have to be a lifetime.
And they both seem so grounded that they were like, okay, you know.
Totally grounded. I met Jen literally in 1990, just before she got Friends. She was moving out of her apartment, her house. She was living with my friend Kim Walker and Ricky Lake. And Kim has since passed away. She was in Heathers. Great movie. If you haven't seen it, you guys were not even born yet at this point. And it was at the beginning. We all sort of were at the beginning of our lives. We were your age. But we weren't millennials. Well, anyway, it's great to be here. Thank you for having me.
Thank you so much for joining us. Here.
So my first question is, can we get reservations to the Palm?
You can always get reservations. Myself or Luke can get your reservations.
I know some people.
Awesome. You know some people. Oh, yes. Yeah. So the Palm is my family business. My great-grandfather started it in New York in 1926. We have 22 locations across the United States, two in Mexico City, and it's truly a family business. It's two Italian families. It started out as an Italian restaurant, and it's a steakhouse now, and it's a joint. And at its core, it's a joint, and I think people like to go there, and celebrities like to go there specifically because they can just be themselves, be taken care of, and just kind of tuck themselves in a corner or be seen and do what they want, but it's fun, and it's good, and we serve good food, so that helps.
I mean, it really is such an iconic restaurant. It's such an iconic institution. Like, how did it become that? And I'm also curious about, like, the caricatures on the walls, which it's obviously known for, and when that started and how that came about. I know it's a family business, a family that he's a part of right here, our very own Lucas.
Full disclosure, he's my uncle.
I am.
And godfather.
Yes. Aww.
Spiritual leader.
Yes, Lucas that. Anthony.
You have misguided him, then.
I really have.
No, in the ways of Madonna, he's guided me perfectly.
I'm a good influence with the Madonna. To answer your questions, though, the how a restaurant becomes iconic, I think, is, you know, we've had the... We're 92 years later. I think that we do it well. It was one restaurant from 1926 to 1972 in Manhattan. In the 70s, it really kind of, it tells the story of sort of history. So if you really look at the Palm in New York, you know, it survived the 30s, World War II, you know, the Vietnam War, the Mad Men era. So it's really, I think that's how it became like iconic in a way because it was part of the fabric. And the caricatures started in the 30s. The area at the time was filled with newspapers. It was a syndicate area. So the artist in the 30s didn't have any money because it was just after the stock market crash. And my great grandfather said, "Just draw on the walls. Just, you know, give us art." So there's a picture of the Palm that's completely white walls, and then over years it just filled up. And that's a rivet of the Palm, and the Palm is a restaurant that when it begins, when it starts, 25 years later, it's a time capsule, you know? So people are alive, they're dead, family members, like, people celebrate it, their families, they go to visit, you know, it's really groovy.
You mention all of the history that has happened, that makes it even more impressive, like, all the wars, it was through so many tumultuous times, it just stood.
Yeah, contextually, if you really think about it, and if you look anything, especially in New York, we all come together, and that particular location, I always say, like, on Second Avenue, if the walls could talk, the stories that they would tell, and it's a real beautiful thing, and it's a place where people celebrate life, and that's why I think we're still going strong 92 years later. It's still a family business, which, as you know, is not easy to do. Most businesses have gone south, and, you know, we get a lot of Rite Aids now and a lot of Dwayne Reeds and a lot of banks in New York City, so it's kind of fun to still have a restaurant.
Yeah, for sure.
Well, clearly, I've been going to the Palm literally since the day I came out of my mom.
Weird wording.
Weird wording.
The day I was born.
Just being literal. People always ask me what my favorite thing is to get at the Palm, and I always say something like not particular to the menu. Everyone thinks steak, lobster, and I always say either the veal Milanese or the chicken parm. What is like the Bruce Bozzi thing that people wouldn't expect that you order at the Palm?
Yeah, you do like a good Parmesan.
Oh, I do. I eat the whole thing too.
I'm very simple. I just love red meat. So I'm a 18 ounce of New York is a great cut if you want to know cuts of beef, because there's a nice mix of the fat content and the leanness. And, you know, sauteed vegetables. You know, I got to keep it real, kids.
Brittany was commenting.
I'm 52.
Yeah. You're doing very well.
Brittany's into you, just saying.
Yeah.
Bam.
I hugged you and the arms were nice.
Okay, thank you.
Bruce is married, Brittany.
I am married.
But for now.
Wonderful guy.
Always, forever.
Right. Yeah. Everybody likes a nice compliment.
I will take it all the time,
absolutely.
Yeah.
I love talking about food. I think it's like the only second time we've talked about food on
Bill
Brunch.
Right. So
it's good to hear about food. Tell us about the famed Chicken Bruno at the Palm.
So Chicken Bruno. So recently I did a piece for the Washington Post that Alex Witchell had asked, like, what was a dish growing up that really resonated? And Chicken Bruno is, I call, the modern day chicken nugget. But it began in the 60s, but my grandfather Bruno, and it's very simple. I mean, you hack up a chicken, so the bones are still in it, which give it a lot of flavor, and it's dusted in flour and sauteed in a pan with butter, and it's really rich, and it's just, for people to really understand it, it's a great chicken nugget.
I'm always curious that menu creation, because you've been open for 90 years, right? Yeah. So like, how often do you readjust it and change it, like, to keep people interested, or do you keep it the same?
Babe?
Yeah, it's a great question.
No, I'm so into that.
No, and it's good, right? You should be talking about food. We changed the menu. The iteration has changed. It was an Italian restaurant, strictly Italian. Our families are from Northern Italy. Then the Mad Men, the Madison Avenue guys wanted steak. And so my grandfather would run up to the butcher shop and became steak. And then my father introduced lobster in the 60s. And our menu changes with the customers as they start to invent dishes or want dishes. And so we've had a number of different add-ons as a result of that. And I think if you do last, it's because you're listening to your customers. So, you know, we try to do seasonal things, but yes, you have your core items. So you want to know that you're going to a Palm and you love steak, you like the chicken parmesan, you want fish. And it's a very diverse, we're a steakhouse, but it's a very diverse menu. But yeah,
A matter of time before we see poke bowls.
Exactly. I mean, right.
Asian food comes there.
Exactly.
Besides your day job, of course, you host a radio show, Lunch with Bruce, on Radio Andy.
Yes.
Which you've interviewed Housewives, like Lisa Vanderpump. You've interviewed Lena Dunham. You have Kelly Ripa coming up, great Kelly Ripa. what can we expect next? Who's coming?
Sure. Lunch with Bruce started with Andy Cohen. Andy's my best friend, and he basically, when we opened the Beverly Hills Palm, reopened our location in L.A., he did what he calls a deep and shallow, and it was just two mics, and we were talking, and we were just bullshitting, and we were talking about food, and we were talking about, you know, who we thought was really sexy in the restaurant that day, and Goldie Hawn was in the restaurant with Bob Daly, and they came over, and he's like, you know what, this is a show, because you were, like, on the inside. Mm-hmm. So I've had the great fortune of doing many people, like Sherry Lansing, who used to run Paramount Pictures, to Matt Bomer, to Lena, who was like, I was very excited. Nora O'Donnell is this Friday, and you know, I get very, you know, very excited when I get someone like Nora O'Donnell, because she's so smart. We're talking about news and the state of truth in 2018. Kelly did it. Kelly's an old-time friend of mine, so she's coming. She's doing it. Today, I'm doing Dorinda. Dorinda will be on Lunch with Bruce. Tomorrow, Jacob Bernstein, who's a writer for the New York Times, whose mother was Nora Ephron, and his father is Carl Bernstein. We're going to do, who else do I have coming up? Anderson Cooper. So I've been able to, I have about like 28, I mean, it's crazy.
It's crazy.
It's, yeah, and it's literally we sit and we eat. Like,
yeah, that's in a booth. I mean, it's.
And the only complaints we get is like, you're chomping in our face. It's disgusting. And Andy and I really chomped that first one. We were like, I mean, it was gross. So.
But also part of what I love at lunch with Bruce is that, especially in the Beverly Hills Palm, because the lunch scene there is so prominent, you'll be like, oh, let's look around who's here. Right. You have Brian Grazer's here.
He always pops over. Oh,
Brian Grazer always pops over. Yeah. Is that like part of the atmosphere of the show? Is this like, you feel like you're part of the Palm?
The idea, Andy's idea was you to start by talking about food, mm-hmm. sort of kind of talking about like, oh, you look great. Like, what are you wearing? Yeah. Set the scene, which you do look great. And then whatever happens, happens. So if people are in the restaurant, you kind of, you know, you name drop, they come over, they see, they run away. So the listener is part of the experience in a different way. So yes, that is a big part of it.
And what does that mean for you? Because obviously you've been in the restaurant industry your entire life, but this is really yours and something that you get to do and you get to shine. So how fun is that for you?
It's super fun. And you know, it took me a while to sort of really get that. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, I started in 2016. And now I'm like, oh yeah, I have a radio show called Lunch with Bruce at the Beverly Hills Palm. Like, that is something that's truly mine. And it's not about the Palm necessarily solely. And it feels very good. And I was first always somewhat hesitant to ask people to be on it because a lot of people I have relationships with. And as I got more comfortable, like with Kelly, I said, Kelly, would you do this? Yeah. Thinking, and she was like, I kind of was waiting for you to ask me. Like, you know, you had Lena on. I was like, yeah, like, of course. So this is, they are billing this the Summer of Bruce on Sirius, on Radio Andy. And they're going to be doing, you know, you know when they run shows all the time?
Yeah, marathon.
Marathon.
That's great. We've already established that I've inherited my love for Madonna from you, but I also inherited my love of tequila from you. Could you tell the story of you and Sarah Poles at the Met Gala that combines Madonna and tequila?
Yes.
I think it's a great story people
so
would love
excited.
To hear.
Well, and funnily enough, she had said, can I tell this story in the Tonight Show? And I didn't think, she asked Brian, my husband, if she could, and I was like, okay, and I happened to catch it. So. These events are crazy and there's a lot of people and you know, you wanna drink and all of a sudden it was time to leave the eating area to walk through the museum, the Met, and then go to where Madonna was going to perform and come down the stairs and da da da. But you couldn't take any alcohol because of all the art. So we had fresh tequila drinks and like we had one and I was like, okay, we can do this. So I put it in my pants, in the front part, like the glass with the ice. So I was like, okay, here, like this. She's like, okay, so we're arm in arm. I'm like, go slow. I'm like, oops, okay, little, you know, dropped out. And she says, you know, by the time we got there, we had like this much left.
Oh my God.
Which we finished, and like we just kind of like placed it on a piece of art, like a statue thing. And then the show started. You know, you gotta sneak tequila.
And did you just smell like tequila for the rest of the night?
Yes, my nethers smelled like my nethers. You know,
it's not
but.
That much different than a normal night out.
Thank you.
I'm kidding.
I love that story.
No, that was a fun story. And Sarah is amazing, and that's the nature of the night. I mean, you gotta. There's so much happening on the Met Ball, and you know, Anna does an incredible job. But you're like, you just turn around, and you're like, wow, like look who's. I helped Katy Perry take off her wings, and you know, I was
who
like,
who hasn't?
Yeah.
Come on. I was like, oh, I can help you with that. But it was good. It was great. Yes, thank you for making me relive that.
No,
Tequila has gotten me in a lot of trouble over the years.
Yeah. You can tell an embarrassing story of me. It's fine. I prepare them. So.
Yeah. Do you have? He's showed us like some photos of him as like a kid in like a Pope costume. He was a little chubby. He was hula hooping.
Yeah.
I mean, he's shared a lot. But is there anything about Luke?
Yeah. Luke
know?
Was always an interesting young man, little boy. He would see like we'd be like in the car and he'd see he could barely talk at the time and he'd say church. So we were convinced he was going to be. He wanted to be a pope, the pope.
That's real.
Not a pope. Or a king. And I saw that he posted a picture of me like walking behind him when he was little, like holding the towel as if it was his. He was always and has been just a lovely, a good kid, and
that's so sweet.
A little emo, a little sensitive. And yes, he was a little, he did go through a little chunky phase.
We love Lucas. We love
you
Lucas.
Guys hit the gym. Yes. Now.
Yeah, now we hit the gym.
You Bozzi boys hit the gym.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, you both look super great. So being fit runs in the family, yeah. Obviously.
Yes, we have a, my mother, his grandmother has taught us well. She's a 77 and she is fierce.
She sounds fierce.
Yeah, golfs, tennis, walks 15,000 steps a day.
Woo. And it's important, I mean, for you guys as well. But your generation kind of came into it. I started working out at 20 in 1985. I was at USC and this girl said, you know, you're really cute, but man, you're so skinny. And I weighed 138 pounds and I was like, yeah. And so that was the beginning also of like the whole workout, Jane Fonda, like the scrunchy socks. It's all coming back, the 80s stuff. Yeah. And from that point on, my advice to you is exercise now so when you do cross the threshold of 50, it's a very easy door.
I'm already feeling it, so I hear you. Yeah.
You guys all look great. Look at this.
Thank you. We're going to Rumble after this.
Yes, you are? My friend just said when you get back to LA, we're going to do Rumble.
Oh, it's killer.
It's killer.
Yeah, I love it so much.
Wow.
I haven't done it, but we're gonna see.
Look at these arms.
Yeah, I mean,
bam.
Look at this.
Awesome.
Well, I also wanted to talk about Boys in the Band on Broadway, because you're a producer of that.
I am. Yeah, sure. Like, it was one of those magical moments. I grew up in New York. One of my oldest and best friends is Joe Manteller, who's directing Boys in the Band. Matt Bomer's a good friend of mine. Tuck Watkins is a very old friend of mine. And theater's a big love of mine. And so they were raising money for the show, and my buddy Joe Mahota, who's an agent at CAA, said, would you be interested in, you know, and I thought, you know what, yeah, like this is, it wasn't even about making money, because making money in theater is not often the case. Mm-hmm. It was about the experience of my book of life to be able to say, you know what, I'm one of the producers, and yes, giving money is, I'm really probably more of a financial investor in it, but it was so, there was such a heart piece of it, you know, especially with Mantello, who, if those of you who don't know, he's directed, you know, Wicked and
Everything. He stinked the Tonys, like every
speech. What was the show? The Three with Laurie Metcalf that was on Broadway.
Oh, yeah.
That was a phenomenal show. So it's been a real cool. It's just one of those things. I don't have a bucket list necessarily, but that was on my bucket list.
Yeah, living in New York your whole life, I think that's so amazing.
Yeah, completely. So that's actually been a great experience. It closes August 11th. Oh. So anyone who wants to see it should see it now. The cast is phenomenal. Andrew Reynolds, Jim Parsons,
Matt.
Yeah. And it was a big deal. Wow. And I didn't tell Brian about it, so he was like, what? And I was like, you know.
We're doing this.
We're doing
some
this.
Some secrets.
Exactly.
Yeah. You know, good to have a shred of mystery.
Yeah. I agree. Exactly. You don't want to full
that.
Disclosure. No.
Lucas told me that you actually were an NBC page.
I was.
So was I. I feel like we were in a fraternity.
Mm-hmm. It really is a lifetime fraternity.
You know? Yes. So I'm curious to hear about your experience in the page program and what that was like for you.
I loved it. It probably was my favorite job. I was a page in 1989. I got out of college. My father had set me up to interview with a guy who was at the time running sports for NBC. And I had not heard of the page program. And so
I thought you were going to say I had not heard of sports.
Well, this basically, so I'm talking to him and he looks at me and he's like, I don't think this is the department for you, sports. I was like, it is. He's like, have you heard of the page program? So hence, I interviewed. It's not an easy interview process. You have to go through the process. And it was the best. You give tours of NBC, which you do usually 4 tours a day, which I loved. Then you have an assignment. So I usually would, in the afternoons, do late Letterman, because that was at 5:30. And I always got the floor position for whatever reason they liked me. On every Saturday, we would give tours and do Saturday Night Live. And I was there the year Saturday Night Live turned 15. I was there the day that Gilda Radner died. You know, you have all these incredible experiences. And I was also one of 2 pages that always worked the 8th floor. So we'd be like, your name's Nana. You need to go upstairs. People want to get
so
on the 8th floor. Yeah. And my last assignment was the Today Show assignment, and nobody wanted it because it was 7 in the morning. I had to get there at 5, so yeah. I was like, I'm in. And by the time I left, everyone wanted it because every day I would come up and I met, you know, Betty Davis, Shelley Winters, Winona Ryder. It was like all those, you know, Ken Olin, all these people, and Jane Paul, and I just had the best time. And I love giving tours, and you were squished in those elevators.
Yeah.
Did you do it in New York?
Yes, or? New York.
One day I was in the elevator and there was about, so you're like this with people, okay? And so, and I had 80s hair, so it was like here. And I'm like, so as we wrap up, are there any questions? And someone's like, I do. Is that a wig? And I'm like, as people are staring this close, I'm like, no, it's not a wig.
The tour's over.
Right, yeah. The tour's over.
You can leave.
Wait, I'm just connecting these dots now because Andy Cohen was also an NBC page.
No. Andy, he worked at CBS. Yeah.
Oh,
at
CBS.
Right, yeah, yeah. Okay. Right. He was CBS. He was with Julie Chen. That was that whole era. So okay, they became buddies. And he was, I think he started it as an intern and then was an associate producer on the early show.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then 48 Hours.
Around. Yeah, 48 Hours.
Yeah, I mean, our friendship started in 1994. I was dating his best friend for 3 years. And at the end of that, I got the best friend, and that's 25, 27 years ago. And his career, obviously, we all know, is great. And I saw you guys last night on Watch What Happens Live because I was bartending.
So. Yeah, you love him. I love, Bruce refers to himself as the most famous, non-famous person in the world.
Yeah.
You really are. You hung out Madonna, J-Lo, Andy, and all the housewives, and yet...
I don't get it.
But that's a perfect place to be. You are the most interesting man. You have like the best stories best experiences, but you have to deal with any of the bullshit.
Yeah,
I know. Allie just had someone take a photo of her on the subway, which is creepy. She didn't even know about it, so you don't want that.
Did they sneak it?
I don't want to be as famous as me.
Yeah, as the great Allie Colbert.
I mean, okay. I was like, no, but I am. For some reason, people, I have had the great fortune of having friends in my life that are really great, talented people who have gone on to some great success, and I feel I've been successful in my life in many ways, and it's not there, but yes, I am. I'm just happen to be in the room a lot.
Yeah, you're in the room.
You really like guard and protect and value those friendships, though, which 100%. Is, I mean, I think the coolest part of it.
Right. Yeah. I do, and they're all authentic, so it's not like, I mean, I think that's why they exist, and why when I say, ask people, my friends, will you do lunch with Bruce, they're happy to do it, because there's no intention. I'm not trying to use someone for something, and I'm genuinely interested in stories and people's narratives, and many people that I know have really done a lot of stuff, and I'm a little crazy too. So it's good.
It's the best combination of you're so genuine, authentic, and just funny and fun, and just like what people. If you ever get to go, if you're at a Palm and Bruce is there, lucky to be there, you just see it. People come to him. Aww. It just is. You just, it revolves around Bruce.
Thank you. Yeah. Thank you. Unless I'm flipping a table.
Yeah. So he does have the Teresa Giudice switch. Andy Cohen labeled it. He can get a little mad, but
I can see it.
He's like, Andy was like, did you understand why she flipped that table? And I was like, oh yeah, no, I got it. Yeah. I knew the exact thing that was said to her that just went like this. He's like, please. I knew you would. Knew you would.
Oh my God. Yeah. Prostitution.
Right. Yeah.
Well, Bruce, thank you so much
thank
for being
you.
Here with us. Such a blast. Let's hang
thank
out again.
You, thank
we're
you.
Doing
oh,
dinner.
It's a pleasure.
We'll
thank
all do
you.
Dinner.
We're all doing dinner, right?
Dinner on me at the Palm. Thank you. Thank you.
And everyone, make sure to go eat at the Palm if you haven't already. And tune into Lunch with Bruce on Sirius XM. We'll see you tomorrow, same time, same table.
Woo!